Definitely. So welcome to this talk. We're going to talk about how to use OpenStack in a research environment and also how to manage OpenStack with a small team or with one member team, more or less. I'm Atze de Vries. I'm from Naturalis Biodiversity, which is a... that's not working. Okay. Yeah. From Naturalis Biodiversity Center, which is a research center based in the Netherlands. And at the website it says, at Naturalis Biodiversity Center we want to describe, understand and explore biodiversity for human well-being and future of our planet, which is a very nice way to say it, but we do research on life in a very broad way. And so we do DNA sequencing to geology, all the parts are there. We also have a very big collection of objects. We have a very big tower with many, many insects and stones and whatever you can find. And we also now, since I think a few months, we have a T-Rex, a real T-Rex, not a replica. And I still like replicas, but in real life, a replica is good. So we are the first company or something outside of the US to have a real T-Rex. So that's quite cool. My job is being a sysadmin and a developer at Naturalis. And I've been working at Naturalis for about 5 years now. And it's been nice. So our current infrastructure, just to get some context of what we are now too, is we have a high performance open cluster of 35 nodes, a backup cluster for backup to disk of 18 nodes, and still an older OpenStack cluster of 18 nodes, and still an old VMware cluster still running. Our default configuration is OpenStack with Ceph as storage backend and instance boot from local disks. And like 4 years ago, we were just a simple IT organization within Naturalis. We just had some Windows servers with running on VMware, and IT was not really a big thing at Naturalis. It was just, you know, a service for people to do some stuff. And then came a change, and IT became big within Naturalis, and so we wanted a better infrastructure. So we thought about getting a change to into our IT infrastructure. And it started with providing compute to scientists. Our scientists, well, some of our scientists use quite intensive calculations. And the solution in the beginning was just to buy a big enterprise workstation. And so they can do the calculations on there. But they tend to break their computers and install software which doesn't work or whatever. So it's really, really hard solution to support. It takes a lot of time. And it's also very inefficient. So you have like one scientist who has a desktop or workstation, and then he uses for 24 hours in a week, and then the rest of the week is just, you know, dead behind the desk. So it wasn't really a very efficient solution. So we thought of different solutions, and one of the solutions was OpenStack. And why OpenStack was a good solution since it's a cloud system, it's easy to share resources. So you have instead of your workstation on your desk, you have some servers in the cloud or in your data center or wherever you are. And you have a more or less sandbox environment, so they can play around with their OS and destroy or whatever. We don't care about it. They just can play around with it. And it also gives them a lot of freedom. You know, you can play with multiple instances and et cetera, et cetera. We also considered at that time, it was like 3 years ago, I think, maybe four, CloudStack and Open Nebula. But at the moment, OpenStack had the best feature set. And at the moment, I say it's good, had been a good choice to go for OpenStack. Getting your science department into OpenStack is not a trivial thing. First, to get some context, is that And the word HPC is like, yeah, can mean quite a lot of things. And the most talks here at over high performance computing at this summit has been, I think, about, you know, parallel big cluster calculations. But at Naturalis, most scientists use like very CPU single threaded high memory instances. So on parallelization is not really a big thing at us. They want just a high performance desktop in the cloud to do their work on. So that's how we also, with that in mind, we also created our first OpenStack. So reasons for scientists to go with OpenStack is, they can share resources more easily. So it's dropping the cost of your systems. They have a lot of freedom. They can do what they want. They have access from anywhere, so they can do it at home or in a, somewhere in a jungle or whatever. They can connect to the cloud if they have internet. And also, I think it's very important part is to they can replay their calculations since you can use the API or cloud in it or whatever. You can recreate your research part in a totally exact way. Downsides of using OpenStack at the moment, and still is a bit, is that the scientists also need some knowledge of computing, also of, you know, how to install an operation system. You can help them with that, but still, if they have a Linux command line shell, it's can be hard for them to work with that. So how to help your scientists and going, getting them working with OpenStack is really have to, you know, teach them, help them quite a lot. So like simple things of creating a SSA key pair or whatever, there's concepts they don't understand. So you really have to help them learn this this stuff. And they're not app developers, they're really just scientists who want to do science on biology or geology or whatever. And you have to create really good documentation also to go out there. And also we did a lot of workshops, you know, just getting the people there and do those workshops and help them for a whole day with getting into OpenStack. And I think maybe one of the most important things is to recruit some key users of some early adopters who are or scientists who are already more or less on the IT side of science, who can make amazing things, and also help other less experienced users into OpenStack. Since as IT guys, we can help them, you know, with installing software, etc. We don't know a lot about software of the science software, so I don't know how to configure and how to configure rightly a DNA sequencing set, whatever. That's so they have to. You need these certain set of users to really get them into your OpenStack. And what was still missing and is a bit is 3D is still. Is you can do really like 3D or reduce GPU stuff in OpenStack now, but it's not really out of the box yet, as far as I have seen. So that's still a thing missing in OpenStack. And we do actually quite a lot of 3D stuff at Naturalis. And also, and that's in the biology science software, is that the cloud-ready software, which can run over multiple nodes, multiple clusters, et cetera, is still not there, or using like one CPU full time. It's all not, it's just not really fully cloud ready. So these are the still downsides of OpenStack at the moment. But I think we saw in the last 3-4 years people still using more and more OpenStack, and they really in the end really like it. They also have the ability to boot a Windows instance, and they can just point and click like they do on their desktop. So they have all the freedom. So the second part is about maintaining your OpenStack. How do you keep it simple so you can manage your OpenStack more or less on your own as a sysadmin? We started 2 years ago. We started with using it for science. And now we are almost ready moving all our workload, just also for applications, web servers, and all the stuff, also moving all it to OpenStack. So, and we're almost there. We still have a few VMware running services, but that's we're almost done there. So OpenStack has grown from, I think, 10 nodes to 17 nodes now in about 3 years. And that's going to be a lot more in the future. So some tips and thoughts I think are really good for making your OpenStack easy and easy to maintain is, as an IT nerd, it's very, always very interesting to get some really nice configuration, but I think it's very important to keep, get away from the really exotic situation, just choose the general defaults which most people use in OpenStack, which maybe not always be the fastest or the cheapest, but just, you know, like for hypervisor, go for a KVM or maybe Xen and not for some strange hypervisor provider, which may be really fast, but we run into trouble in the end with getting support or help from other people. Also, important is to get a really sensible configuration. Just look, you can do lots of things, and you can, for example, go for HH for high available controllers, whatever, but you really have to think about, especially if you just look at science, do I really, really need that? Does my science department really needs 24/7 availability of the OpenStack? So if you remove high availability from your cluster, then it's just gets simple and gets easier to debug and easier to maintain than in the end. And also, do you really need shared storage for booting your instances? We almost boot all our instances just to local disks, which is way much cheaper and also way much faster. Not always, but in general. So really check and give a good review of what you really need in your OpenStack. Also very important, especially if you go from the traditional VMware mindset, is to get rid of erosion pets and breed your cattle. So I think most people are familiar with the pets and cattle thing. So try to get rid of your very big Windows installations, and which takes really lots of hours to set up, and try to split your service. So if you have a Windows who does like many things like web server and file server, whatever, try to make them in smaller pieces and make them all different services. So that's a very important thing to make your life easier as a OpenStack admin. Also very important is go for configuration management. Tools like Puppet or Chef or Ansible or CF Engine, you have like a really big array of configuration management tools. OpenStack is really a perfect problem of a platform for working with these tools, and we almost have our full infrastructure into a code, into where we use Puppet, and we can recreate our whole infrastructure just replaying this this code. One thing I think we learned about using configuration management is that you have to invest time to make it really good, and really start using it when you know it's really good. Don't do half work, and then it's going to be a pain in the ass in the end again. So when you do it really good. Also, that's maybe a little bit from the other slide, but try to go for systems that don't depend on a high available storage. So go for web servers with load balances, etc., etc. So things like that. What also helped us to make life a little bit easier is to use OpenStack API. So you have, of course, a Horizon dashboard or the command line tools, but you can also write scripts upon the API to help you manage manage your system. For example, we use it to create flavors and create projects and to assign access to projects. And also we use the API with a synchronization for Active Directory. So we don't use the direct LDAP connection, but just to sync it, just keep it a little bit more simple. Since if you have like a lot of users and somebody goes away from a company, you generally forget to remove him from OpenStack, etc. So it's really handy to use these tools to make it easier. I have some examples of that. For example, well, here are some YAML configuration of creating a flavor. So we just define how many CPUs, how many RAM, and how many disk. And the nice thing is we put these configurations into GitHub. So you also have you can refer back to previous configurations if you have just a change management of how you change your OpenStack. And this is the YAML file which defines the configuration. And here is a piece of Python code which creates these flavors. So it's about 20 lines of code. It's really simple to use this this API. We also use it for creating our projects. And this is the first bit of a YAML, and next slide is the next piece of YAML. So it just defines how the project is named and which groups have access to the projects and the quotas and et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So here's the network configuration also of how many subnets and floating IPs it can create and the flavors which has access to it. And I don't have the piece of code over here since it's more complex, Python code to create it. Especially the Neutron was quite quite different from the rest. And the last thing, I think it's really important to make your life more easier, get a third-party support. We self-use Mirantis, but it's totally up to you and up to your situation which party you use. But it's, you know, in the end you have always complex bugs or bugs who need to get fixed upstream. And if you totally deploy your OpenStack yourself, then it's really hard to get these bugs forward patched in an older level of OpenStack or whatever. The first OpenStack we wrote, we did it ourselves with Puppet and we deployed the OpenStack ourselves, but getting upgrades then was really a complex thing. So then we choose to go with a third party supplier. One thing though is that I found that if you go for a third party support, then now, since OpenStack is a freedom and it's a vendor lockout system, if you go for a third-party support, there it's harder to move to a other party. So, if you go, for example, to Mirantis, then Ubuntu won't support you. Then you have to really move your whole cloud to a different cloud, etc. So, choose wisely. And then the question part. And first, before. I'll say one thing is that you can also ask me questions afterwards personally. There's also a colleague of mine over here at the corner who also can answer your questions. So, are there any questions? Yeah.
As I understand, the scientists are from your organization, so probably they don't have to pay for resources, which I reserve. Do you have some problem with empty machines, empty VMs, which are provisioned? In most cases, scientists make some batch processing, so they do some computing, and then machine reservation is on, but the machine is empty.
So your question is, I think, is that how do you manage your resources on your hypervisor in an efficient way when scientists only use for 10% of the time? And your first question is that, well, you first assume that the scientists don't pay for the hypervisors. Well, yeah, no, but in our company, more or less indirectly, they pay for the hypervisors. Since at the moment we still have enough resources, we don't really care about inefficient resources. So in our situation, it's not really a big problem. But yeah, you can, of course, teach the teach the scientists to delete their or snapshot their instances when they're not in use. Any other questions? Yeah, I know. It's also a solution. It's also a very good solution, I think, though. At the time then, it was a more complex situation than writing your own scripts. So it's just how you use it. Yeah. And I believe you also have to update your ID schematics to allow Keystone to afford, but I'm not sure. Any other questions? Yeah? We use a Mrans-based deployment, which uses Vue as a deployment tool, which in the end is at the moment still Puppet. And our first OpenStack was using Puppet, but the Vue scripts are written by Mrans, not by us. So that's. Any other questions? No? Okay. Well, that was it then.